This is Dr. Anil Joshi welcomes you to his series Learn Radiology from Dr. Anil Joshi. There are different modalities, there are different diseases, and in radiology, if you want to interpret properly, you will have to have a proper understanding of appropriate modalities also and embryology also. Today's topic is Mullerian duct anomalies, and as obviously it's an embryological topic, so if you want to interpret properly radiology, if you want to interpret properly either HSG, then USG or MRI, a proper understanding of embryology and development is must. Today's lecture also includes review of our original article over the congenital anomalies of uterus as detected by HSG. So also one of our presentation in international journal, that is MRS syndrome, which we are going to discuss in detail in subsequent files or subsequent slides. At the onset, I want to disclose certain things. Most of the material is from our original article and our original research. However, certain portion is borrowed from the net, which is free download and royalty free. We have got here most of the material, which is a research material from our department and from our original papers, but whatever is downloaded is free of royalty, and it is royalty free, and we do not accept any medical legal responsibilities on our article. This should not be used as a baseline for anything. This should not be quoted as the medical legal aspects, and it is meant only for medical students to learn. Now, this is the original article which we had. It is the cover page of the international journal over the Mullerian duct anomalies as detected by the HSG. Now, here we go to one after another each topic. At the introduction, I want to make certain things clear. Female reproductive organs are developed from Mullerian duct. To understand type of anomalies and its presentation, understanding of embryological basic is crucial. This lecture briefly runs over the developmental process and emphasizes more on its presentation and its imaging features. That is, certain part is covered of the embryology, of the clinical aspect, but the more emphasis is on the imaging and our original images which we are going to show at the end of lecture. Now for Mullerian duct anomalies etiology. Although teratogenic exposures such as thalidomide group of drugs are blamed, so also diethyl stibestrol, also popularly called as DES in short form, then there are different factors like polygenetic, then familiar, that is hereditary. These are also factor along with exposure to radiation, which is not as significant in the present era, since a due precaution is taken not to expose anybody unless it is indicated, and not definitely to expose pregnant patients. Then above all factors are linked with the anomalies. Now, how is the development takes place? The vagina above the hymen are derived from Mullerian ducts, and abnormal development of these ducts during embryogenesis results into various congenital anomalies of the uterus, which we are going to subsequently see. This is the embryological basis, and this happens during the sixth week of intrauterine life, that is at 10 millimeters of CRL according to our sonography. There are two Mullerian ducts, paramesonephric of secondary type development. Now what happens with further development? Partially fused parts from the fundus of the uterus. Then that is, there are two Mullerian duct which fuses to form the fundus. Then unfused or unused parts develop into the uterine tube. The thickening of the myometrium comes from the surrounding mesoderm. These are the embryological details diagrams which will give you a brief idea how the development takes place. Now, how the Mullerian duct anomalies are classified. Now, according to the American Fertility Society, AFS, there are different classes. Now, let's go to the class 1. Agenesis or hypogenesis of the uterus is the most common form of the MRKUH syndrome, or popularly called as MRS. It is combined agenesis of uterus, cervix and upper portion of the vagina, and these patients presents with primary amenorrhea. Now, classification of the Mullerian duct abnormalities, we are continuing further. We are seeing class 1, now let's go to class 2. Uniconic uterus is due to unilateral separation of Mullerian ducts leading to a unilateral rudimentary horn at or the left or the right side of the midline. Since there are two ducts, so either one will be absent. The unicornate uterus communicates only with the ipsilateral fallopian tube. If the contralateral horn is almost fully developed, a full-term pregnancy is believed to be possible. So, unicornate uterus, we have to take precautions, especially after 32 weeks if we want to deliver a normal baby. Otherwise, they will go to the premature labor. Now, class 3, that is diadelphus. Uterus results from the complete failure of the fusion of the two Mullerian ducts, leading to a duplication of uterus, the cervix and the vagina. The single vagina or a vaginal septum may be noted, since each horn is almost fully developed. Uterus patients has been known to carry pregnancies till full term. So in this also, like one here also, class 1 and 2 can deliver a normal baby with due precautions. Now let's go to class 4. A bicornate uterus results from the partial fusion of the Mullerian ducts. This anomaly is characterized by double uterus and double cervix, that is bicornis bicolis, or double uterus with a single cervix, bicornis unicolis. The bicornate uterus demonstrates some degree of fusion between the two horns, and they are usually not fully developed. We can distinguish this from diadelphus uterus, in which the two horns of the cervix are separated completely and the horns are fully developed. This further we are going to discuss as the lecture advances. We are going to come back to this topic. Now let us come to the classification of Mullerian duct anomalies, continuing as the class 5 now, that is the septate uterus. Apparently the uterus is normal, but the septum divides the uterus into the two parts. The septum can be partial or complete. A woman with uterine septum have a high incidence of miscarriage. Let's continue with the classification of Mullerian duct, that is class 6. That is arcuate uterus. The fundus is concave, otherwise uterus is normal. The endometrial cavity demonstrates a small concave dimple or a cleft which is more than or which is less than 1.5 centimeters. This anomaly is often considered a normal variant. It is not significantly associated with increased risk of miscarriages. Now coming to class 7. This is the des uterus, that is a T-shaped uterus. The female fetuses of the pregnant woman treated with DES, that is diethyl stilbestrol, show uterine hypoplasia and T-shaped uterine cavity. The DES was an estrogen analog described to prevent miscarriages from 1945 to 1971. The drug was later on withdrawal due to its teratogenic effects. Now, there are another type of classification, that is Telenius modified classification of American Fertility Society classification of uterovaginal anomalies. In this, there are following varieties. In class 1, there is dysgenesis of the Mullerian duct. In class 2, there is disorder of vertical fusion of the Mullerian duct, and in class 3, the disorders of the lateral fusion of the Mullerian duct, and in class 4, unusual configuration of the vertical or lateral fusion defects. Now, septal resorption. This is the embryological process. After the lower Mullerian duct fuses, a central septum should also resolve to form a single uterine cavity and cervix. Failure of resorption of this causes a septate uterus. Now, coming to a fusion. Types of fusion. A. Lateral fusion of the lower segment of the paired Mullerian ducts from the uterus, cervix and upper vagina can occur, and failure of fusion results in bicornate or didelphous uterus. Now B. We have seen A, that is lateral fusion of the lower segment, and B, vertical fusion of the ascending sinovaginal bulb with a descending Mullerian system forms a normal and patent vagina. That is, incomplete vertical fusion results in a imperforate hymen. Now, how is the distribution of these anomalies? Whatever statistic we are giving is from our own study and in our region. Bicornate is top on the list with 39%, septate 34%, didelphic 11%, arcuate 7%, unicornate 5%, and hypoplastic, aplastic, solid or other forms makes up 45% of the total distribution. Now, hysterosalpingography is investigation performed in detection of these anomalies. There are two basic investigations. As soon as the patient present, usually an ultrasound is performed, and according to the ultrasound findings, the further investigations are advised. As far as conventional radiology is concerned, HHG stands as a gold standard as on today because of its different advantages, which we are going to discuss, and our whole paper is based on these. Now, abnormalities that can be detected at HHG include congenital anomalies, polyps, changes, synecdoche, leiomyomas and adenomas. The HHG is invaluable in investigation of infertility, especially to know the patency. Mere presence of a fallopian tube with its proper peristalsis as well as its functioning is best visualized on HHG. That's why it stands as one of a gold standard even as on today. Then we have published our original articles. There are two articles. One is on the anomalies which we are discussing right now, and second was about the tubal factors. Now, let's come to the clinical role of Mullerian duct anomalies. Now, clinical applications are in female infertility. Because it's not an uncommon problem, in suspected cases of tubal occlusion, salpingitis, that is ischemica nodosa, polyps, hydrosalpinx and peritubal adhesions are few to enlist, but there are multiple indications and multiple applications. Now, Mullerian duct anomalies are important in evaluation of these sterility cases. They cause anomalies of vagina, uterus, fallopian tubes and ovaries. Let us consider them one by one. Now, infertility can be due to problems in either partner or in the both. Male is responsible in about 30-40% of the cases, the females in 40-55% cases, and both are responsible in about 10% of the cases. Now, clinical aspects. We are continuing. Clinical aspects of infertility. Primary infertility is defined as the inability to conceive after 12 months of regular unprotected sexual intercourses. The secondary infertility refers to those who have conceived at some or the other time in the past. The other presentation of Mullerian duct anomalies. patient can have repeated abortions, then cervical incompetency, proterm labor, intrauterine growth retardations, abnormal fetal life, obstructed labor, and retained placenta. Now, let's start part 2, that is the types of abnormal uterus. We are going to see now abnormalities, how they manifest, how to diagnose them, how to correct them. Surgically, medically is going to be guided or directed by a radiologist. Now, role of HSG in biconiate uterus. It allows evaluation of uterine cavity and a tubal patency. So it also diagnoses that it is a biconiate uterus, and it gives whether tubes are patent unilaterally or bilaterally. The anomalies may be suggested as visualization of two uterine cavities. Distinguishing septa, diadelphus and biconiate is usually possible. It is sometimes not possible to perform if there is abnormality prohibiting entry of the vagina. That is, the speculum cannot be introduced, you cannot catch the cervix, neither dye can be pushed. In that condition, there is a limitation to this process and this anomaly cannot be detected. That is one of the limitations of HSG, which is already covered in our research article. Now, differential diagnosis between a septate and biconiate uterus. It is important to know a septate uterus, the difference between septate uterus and biconiate uterus, since the treatment differs. How the treatment differs, we are going to see it now. The septate uterus are treated using transvaginal hysteroscopic resection, so comparatively easy, and it is outside procedure. While surgery is possible and or indicated for biconiate uterus, often it is a abdominal approach, or they have to perform surgery as per their convenience and their anomalies detected. Now, septal uterus, now we are showing here diagrams, that is the midline septum can be seen of variable length and can be muscular or fibrous. In diagram, the septum is shown as extension of the uterine myometrium causing septation within the uterus. The midline septum can extend into the variable length and can be muscular or fibrous. In diagram, the septum is thin and linear as expected in the or it indicates a fibrous nature. Since the composition of the septum varies, whenever it is composed of muscular or fibrous tissues, the treatment also may differ accordingly, and surgical approach also may be different for the different types. Now, the characteristic findings indicate that there will be two cornos or it will biconoid, the fundus will be indented, then varial degree of the septation of the uterine horns may be seen, and that is best seen on HSG. Minimal reproductive problem, however, can have pregnancy loss, particularly repeated abortions will be known in these patients, and HSG may be needing a laparoscopy for the surgery, and septation can be removed by the help of surgery. The normal external surface of the uterus will be seen on the endoscopy or laparoscopy, and a diagnosis of laparoscopy may be needed if HSG is inconclusive. Now, differential diagnosis between a septate and biconiate uterus, often we have to make it radiologically, maybe on ultrasound, maybe on HSG or on MRI. It is important, since septate uteri are treated using transvaginal hysteroscopy resection of the biconiate uterus. And otherwise, if it is biconiate uterus, they have to resect it intra-abdominally. Now, this is the classification, class 7, and these are the anomalies of the uterus related to diethyl salbutamol. Then uterine anomaly in this scene patient, the uterine anomaly is seen in these females offering or female offsprings of such as many as 15% of women exposed to DES. Now, this statistic we have to borrow since it is not used nowadays, neither we can see the effects because of the diethylsilbestrol. Uterus is hypoplastic and show a T-shaped uterine cavity. The abnormality is still seen, but the use of the drug is not there. It is not used in clinical practice now. Cervix may be or may have abnormal transverse ridge hoods, or it may be there may be a stenosis. This was a drug induced, and this is a diagram which shows the septate uterus, a partial and the complete, both you can see. And this is the archaeoid uterus, mild thickening of the midline fundus myometrium resulting in fundal cavity or resulting in fundal cavity indentation, but normal outer fundal counter. Some author considered this as a normal variant. It is not associated with increased risk of obstetric or gynecological complications. Now we are coming to class 4, that is archaeoid uterus. Now in this class 4 type of uterus, the endometrial cavity demonstrates a small fundal cleft or impression which is less than 1.5 cm. The outer counter of the uterus is convex or flat. So this is well appreciated in HAG. The form is a normal variant. It is not significantly associated with increased risk of pregnancy loss and other complications found in the subsequent. Here it is shown as the septate uterus, partial and complete. Now here we are seeing a unicorn. These are the diagrammatic representations of the whatever anomalies we are seeing. Unicornate uterus and unicornate uterus with a rudimentary uterine horn. Now this is the archaeoid uterus, while mild thickening of the midline fundal myometrium is seen resulting into fundal cavity depression indentation. But normal outer fundal counter, that is what we have seen and is appreciated in HAG also. Some author consider this as a normal variant and it is not associated with increased risk of obstetrical complications. Now unicornate with a rudimentary horn. Again, same pathology. In this diagram, there are different types shown. Again, this is diagrammatic representation of septate uterus, archaeoid uterus, and DES uterus, that is T-shaped uterus. Now, in addition to the anomalies we are seeing, there are certain other anomalies also, that is acute antiversion and cervical canal stenosis or elongated cervix. All the three factors cause significant difficulty when HAG is performed. The reason is it is difficult to put a retrograde contrast through all these things. Now, these conditions can be present since birth. In some of the patients, it can be considered as a normal variant, but it does create a problem in fertility. Incomplete uterine folds can be normal variants and are seen on HAGs. They can be caused by infolding of the luminal aspect of the myometrium in an under-distended uterus. Means when the uterus is not totally distended, when the contrast is not filling entirely the uterus, these things can be seen. Now, acute antiversion and cervical canal stenosis or elongated cervix, we are continuing, and they can be caused by unfolding of internal aspect of the myometrium. Now, let us come to our research work, that is the Mullan duct anomalies review of our original HHG. That is the paper which was published internationally. It is the most commonly advised, HIG is the most commonly advised and performed first line diagnostic test in cases of primary infertility. HIG is relatively easy to perform, low cost and well accepted and economical as compared to primary infertility. The previous studies, and this is harmony with the finding in the present study, and we are finding 14% of the congenital anomalies in the uterus. We have conducted a study in which we have found that 14% of the cases were abnormal. Then the HIG is relatively easy to perform, low cost, well accepted, and infertility compared to primary infertility in previous studies. This is a harmony with the findings. Please repeat this slide, earlier deletion. Advantages of HIG. It is the most commonly advised and performed test, the first line diagnostic test in cases of primary infertility. All these patients who has come to the HIG has most of the time undergone USG before to give us a guideline, and the main aim remains as the detection of uterine anomalies, uterine structures, as well as tubal patency. It is easy to perform, it's a low cost and well accepted. It fairly detects in primary infertility anomalies like congenital anomalies, and its incidence is 14%. Whether it is significant or not is not a question, but it does detect, and they are useful as far as treatment aspect is concerned. Now, it is performed during 7 to 12 day of the menstrual cycle, that is day 1 being first day of the menstrual bleeding. So this is the first day. Now you count the days and do it on 7th to 12th day. This procedure was performed on OPD basis and no specific patient's preparation is required. The procedure is done before patient ovulates for the next month to avoid the ovum being radiated by the X-ray during the HIG process of the same cycle. Of course, it is always better to have, or always it is taken as the informed consent. First we inform patient and then we take consent in the writing. In that we explain patient the procedure, we explain patient the pain factor, we explain patient the post-procedural care, and we tell them about the complications also. But at the same time, we also emphasize on the advantages it has got. Now, procedural details. Pre-medication given is an injection of atropine, 0.5 cc of the contrast. That is the pre-medication. First is atropine, second is 0.5 cc of contrast. That is a test dose 20 minutes before the procedure. Steroids are used if we are suspecting, or if patient gives certain history earlier as a pre-medication, that is betnasone as a pre-medication, if we are suspecting anything abnormality in the earlier history. Some patients may have cramping pain during the HIG. There are two factors for it. One may be because of the position, and second may be patients may be keeping leg strength stiff. To avoid it, patient was given analgesics drugs half an hour to 1 hour before the procedures to reduce the pain factor. The patients are placed in a supine position on the fluoroscopy table in the modified lithotomy position. That is, the patient is placed at the foot end of the table and asked to flex her legs. Now, this sometimes causes cramps, as I have already mentioned. So, in that way, if patient has got more relaxed, if patient is more comfortable, if patient is free of the fear and pain, they cooperate better. Now, what is the procedure? Retroversion is corrected first if it is there. Otherwise, the contrast will not enter into the uterine cavity. Then the first film is obtained under the fluoroscopy. When we see the dye has entered the uterine cavity, it has gone into the tubes but not across the fallopian tubes. Otherwise, once the dye goes through the fallopian tubes into the peritoneal cavity, it causes overlapping and the picture becomes little difficult to interpret. So first film is taken when the dye is only in the uterus, or contrast is only in the uterus and the fallopian tubes. The second film is obtained when tubal passage of the contrast is there and there is a peritoneal spillage into the abdominal cavity. Now, usually 10 cc of contrast is enough, and once we are sure that contrast has entered in or crossed the fallopian tubes, there is a spill, there is no need to give additional contrast. Documents are made and they are reviewed in the CR room along with the findings of fluoroscopy. Now, the salient points of our research study. Our study demonstrated that bicornuate uterus is the most common congenital anomaly. In said region, the congenital uterine anomalies are found to be 14%, which is statistically insignificant, however important, because a lot of them are correctable. So it is important to document them and important to treat them. There are certain informations which we are receiving after the follow-up of the HAG. In bicornuate unicollis uterus, septum can be surgically resected. So the patients are treated surgically and they conceive in future life. In unicornuate uterus, adequate prevention care can be taken after 32 weeks. So this is a very important information the radiologists are passing to a gynecologist. Then in unicornuate uterus, I said after 32 weeks, you have to be very cautious to prevent a premature labor. In cervical canal stenosis, a simple dilatation procedure is adequate and curettage if required. That is usually followed, both dilatation and curettage. And it's curative and most of the patient, it suffices. Then acute antiflexion, hypoplastic uteruses needs hormonal correction. So if uterus is hypoplastic, then hormonal therapy is given and they are happy with it. Because they conceive. Now, impression. Hysterosulfonylgeography is the gold standard and cost-effective method in diagnostic workup of female patient with infertility. It is highly sensitive method of assessing the integrity of the female genital tract. Despite new innovations and recent advances in the imaging field, HHG remains a frontline radiographic modality in detecting tubal and uterine factors causing infertility. Because ultrasound, the important limitation is visualization of the tubes and visualization of the passage of the either saline which we are injecting in sonosalpingography or otherwise, the patency is little controversial, or it can be appreciated by one. But in HHG, it can be appreciated by anybody because it is on the film. Thus, the result of our research study indicate that the congenital anomalies of uterus do not main reason of infertility is important because it is a correctable. Now, many of the anomalies are correctable. Their timely detection is important to treat cases of infertility. With widespread acceptance of the HHG as a basic imaging modality, which leads to prompt treatment and surgical corrections. It is very important that radiologists should become familiar with HHG techniques and interpretation of HHG images and possibly complications of this to give patient maximum benefit of this very simple and very, very effective test. Now, HHG has both therapeutic and diagnostic values. Now, this is important thing to know. Following HHG, certain minor mild uterine adhesions and partial tubal occlusions are lysed. Improvement is also possible in patients of fallopian tube because of the flushing of the tubes. Tube get flushed by the dye passing out and patient conceive many times after the procedure. There is interestingly a good statistic which says that post HAG the rate of conception has increased. Now, hysterosulfonylgeography has both therapeutic and diagnostic values, as we see. Now here we are going to come to a film reading session. These are all from our own research paper. The first group is different patients showing acute antiversion. The second group is different patients showing intrauterine band adhesions, folds or sanity. Now here we are seeing different patients showing bicornate unicornis uterus. All are different patients. Then different patients showing cervical canal stenosis. Then different patients showing arcuate uterus. Now different patients showing hypoplastic uterus. Now all these things we have discussed very much in detail in the lecture before, and now we are seeing the images also. Go slowly through these images, try to analyze yourself so that you can get the diagnostic features. Then here different patients are showing T-shaped uterus number one, and there are unicornate uterus below. Now we have come to end of our first paper. Now our second paper was over Meyer, Rokitansky, Kuster, Hauser syndrome, or popularly it is called as MRS. Now this is our own research paper which we have published, or it was also presented in a national level conference. This is the detail about the journal and about the article. Now diagnostic criteria of MRS syndrome. The MRK syndrome is characterized by congenital aplasia of uterus and the upper part of the vagina in the woman, showing normal developmental of the secondary sexual characters and a normal 46XX karyotypes. Isolated uterovaginal aplasia is referred to as a Rokitansky sequence of the type 1 isolated MRK syndrome. So it has got many types, many variants and many subtypes, and they have got different incidences. So you have to fit this case. At the end of this we will see in which group it fits. Now incomplete aplasia and associated with other malformation is generally referred to as MURCS, associated with other type of MRK syndrome. These are the short form used because the words are very lengthy. Now here we are going to tell you how we detected a case, how we investigated a case, what is the role of all different type of investigations in it. Then what are the other type of anomalies associated, that also we should know. That is not only with MRS but any of the Mullerian duct anomalies. Now type 2 or MURCS associated are renal, that is unilateral agenesis, then agenesis, ectopia, kidney or horseshoe kidney, then skeletal anomalies are particularly of the vertebral, that is Klippel-Feld anomaly, fused vertebrae, mainly cervical or the scoliosis. The patient can have hearing defects and they can have cardiac or digital anomalies. So when you are detecting patient of MRS syndrome on ultrasound, please see that other anomalies are also looked for. Maybe some of them will have different type of combinations. Now here we present a case. It was a 13-year-old girl presenting with a primary amenorrhea. So due to periodical pain she was facing, we thought of doing ultrasound first due to its age and marital process. She was unmarried, so only ultrasound was done. Now ultrasonography finding revealed the uterus was bicornate with continuity missing from cervix adjacent to it, with a dilated tube-like structures which we could not identify well on the ultrasonography, and the structure was above the bladder. Now a well-defined cystic lesion tapering towards fundus of the uterus with normal right ovary was seen. Now it is important to know ovaries develop separately, so even though there anomalies of Mullerian duct, certain portion of the uterus, that is unicornic uterus, certain portion of the fallopian tube may not be there, but still ovary can be identified because the source or the development is different. So here that is what we found. Now we did a CT scan. Now what CT scan revealed? Uterus was mild heterogeneously echogenic, that is the ultrasound finding collection in the endometrial cavity. What CT will reveal is the low attenuation fluid, then enlarged tubular structure noted on either side of uterus with again echogenic on ultrasound and low density, near fluid density on CT. Now bladder was slightly thick wound and there was no postvoid residue, but the bladder wall was thick, maybe because of cystitis or more likely because of the reason which we are going to tell you subsequently. Now finding suggestive of hematoma with hydrosulfinx was suspected and therefore we went for the MRI. These are the CT findings. Let's go to MRI. These are the MRI findings. It was a unicornic uterus with a single tube with minimal collection in the uterine cavity, right tube grossly dilated, hydrosulfinx and filled with hemorrhagic fluid that you can appreciate on MRI. Single ovary is identified close to the dilated tube. Now a doubtful fissure tract was noted between the bladder and going towards the perineum, and this was not fitting with any of the embryological basis. So we went for a further diagnosis or further evaluating MRI. On T1W, hyperintense signal of the tube, then T2, again hyperintense signal of the tube, and on STIR, hypointense signals of the tube was noted. And T1 fat saturation, there were hyperintense signals. Now graded CT cystogram was advised in view of fistulous communication. What is a graded cystogram is the bladder is filled with the contrast and it is not totally filled. The serial X-rays or CT scan, either way it will work, are taken to know whether the fistulous tract is patterned, where it is going, and as the bladder distends, you have to take at least 3 to 4 times the CT pictures, CT sections, and at end of it, postvoid you have to take. Now we are coming to the end of lecture, that is the conclusive mark. Then for molar duct anomalies, there are multiple anomalies of the Mullerian duct which we have just now seen, we have discussed, we have seen the different imaging patterns. Now it's an embryological based pathology and imaging method are multiple, maybe ultrasound, maybe X-ray, maybe CT or maybe MRI. So initially you investigate this patient with ultrasound, depending on the findings of ultrasound you take them for the MRI. CT often is not required in these patients. Now there are multiple anomalies of the Mullerian duct. If its embryological basis is known, the imaging pattern and reporting become meaningful and beneficial, not only for the patients, because a surgical approach can be either operative intra-abdominal or it can be a transvaginal endoscopically. So patients are benefited. Surgeons know their approaches well and it is speedy recovery for the patient if it is endoscopically treated. Now common anomalies include unicornic, then hematosulfinx in this patient of what we are talking of, the MRS syndrome, then absent communication between cervix and perineum, agenesis of the vagina indicate possibility of MRS syndrome. So MRS syndrome is subsequent diagnosis. Initially they come with a primary amenorrhea, then you start detecting multiple organs, First you see for the uterus, then you see for the vaginal echoes, then you see for the ovaries, and depending on the absent or present or abnormal structure, you proceed for the next investigation. Now at conclusion, HSG is a good diagnostic tool, whether it is MRS or primary sterility. Now HSG is an investigation of choice when USG evaluation of primary infertility cases is done and they need additional information. Its role is proven beyond doubt for detection of mullary and duct anomalies. It is relatively easy to perform, low cost, well accepted in infertility workup because it is availability, cost, and it is easily done at any of the centers and any of the peripheral hospitals. Our present study, in a conclusive remark, we do see that as far as mullary anomaly and HSG is concerned, our percentage was only 14%, which may not be statistically significant. With this, we come to the end of our lecture over mullary and duct anomalies. In this lecture, we have seen what is the embryological basis of the mullary and duct anomalies, how the mullary and duct anomalies are classified, what are the types of anomalies, what are the combination in which they can present, what are the investigation of choice in which we should do them, maybe ultrasound first with MRI at end, and after that it will guide us or our findings to the approach to a surgeon to get them either a surgical treatment, medical treatment, hormonal treatment or otherwise. That will be decided by the radiologist. Therefore, role of radiologist is extremely important. You must master this good technique of HSG so that the technical errors can be eliminated and patient can be given maximum benefit. With this, I thank you for giving me your valuable time. Please note, radiology is not a race. It's a process. It's a continuous process. Be a part of this it. Be a part of this process and enjoy the feast of knowledge. With that, not only you can do good to the patient, but you can do a meaningful results. You can give meaningful results, which will speed up the infertility investigation and workup. With this, I, Dr. Anil Joshi, logs off till we meet again. Do your best. Take care.